The mitochondria serve as a central hub connecting all the hallmarks of aging. So treating mitochondrial dysfunction can have a huge impact on the aging process. Today, we'll look at improving mitochondrial health. I'd like to take a moment to remind everyone that I'm now offering personalized longevity coaching. If you'd like to learn about this 12-week program, just click on the link right up here in the description below, or it will come up again at the end of the video. Now, I've talked about the mitochondria quite a bit in previous videos, but not for a while now. And there's been some advancements in our understanding of mitochondria and in treating mitochondrial dysfunction. So I think it's time for a new video. Okay, before we get started, I'd like to do a brief recap about what the mitochondria are, what mitochondrial dysfunction is, how it impacts aging, and some of the things that you can do about it. And let's start with, what are the mitochondria? So the mitochondria are tiny organelles that are part of the makeup of almost every cell in our body. And they're responsible for creating ATP, the energy source that powers all of our cells. Mitochondria are part of virtually all the cells of every species of plant or animal in existence. They're critical to life on this planet, and they go into decline as we age. Now, mitochondria are more dense in tissues that have higher energy demand, like the heart, liver, brain, and muscle cells. In fact, a single muscle cell can contain up to 2,500 to 3,000 mitochondria. Now, mitochondria have their own DNA called mitochondrial DNA, which is distinct from the chromosomal DNA in the nucleus of our cells. Mitochondrial DNA is passed down from our mothers and is highly susceptible to damage. And it's this damage that plays a big part in the mitochondrial dysfunction and in the aging process. So let's back up for a moment and take a look at ATP. ATP stands for adenosine triphosphate, a molecule with three phosphate groups. Energy is released when one of the phosphate bonds is broken. Mitochondria take elements from the food that we eat and combine it with oxygen from the air that we breathe to produce ATP through a process called cellular respiration. Now, this is an incredibly complex process, but in a nutshell, it consists of three primary steps: glycolysis, the citric acid cycle or Krebs cycle, and oxidative phosphorylation. Now, during this process, a molecule of glucose is combined with oxygen to produce carbon dioxide, water, and 38 molecules of ATP. 32 of those molecules are created during the oxidative phosphorylation phase through a process called the electron transport chain. Along the way, several coenzymes are generated, with the most important being nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, also known as NAD. NAD passes electrons back and forth in the electron transport chain, and it has two states, NAD plus and NADH. Now, this process, while it produces ATP, also produces a free radical called reactive oxygen species, or ROS, as a waste product. And these free radicals can damage the delicate mitochondria and their DNA, leading to mitochondrial dysfunction. Okay, so the primary job of the mitochondria is to produce ATP, and when the mitochondria are healthy, they produce all we need, right? But mitochondrial health depends on three things: how efficient each mitochondrion is at producing ATP, how many efficient mitochondria there are in the cell, and how efficient the cells are at removing dysfunctional mitochondria. And here's the thing: signs of mitochondrial impairment can appear nearly a decade before the onset of permanent mitochondrial damage. Now, if you catch it in time, mitochondrial dysfunction is reversible. Mitochondrial dysfunction can be caused by processes on both the macro and the micro scale. Now, at the macro scale, poor nutrition and lack of activity or exercise can be to blame. However, at the micro scale, things get a little bit more complicated. So there's two processes that are constantly going on within the mitochondria: fusion and fission. And keeping them in balance is critical to mitochondrial health. Mitochondrial fusion is when the mitochondria fuse together to overcome small amounts of damage. But as they become more damaged, they can trigger mitophagy, a specialized form of autophagy that recycles damaged mitochondria. And mitophagy triggers mitochondrial fission, which is where the mitochondria fragment, degrade, and get recycled. However, as we age, accumulated damage and lower ATP production causes a decline in mitophagy. As a result, mitochondria don't fragment, stuff doesn't get recycled, and fusion and fission fall out of balance, with more fusion happening than fission. But A couple of other things contribute to mitochondrial dysfunction. Now, as I mentioned earlier, ROS can damage mitochondrial DNA. It's been estimated that mitochondrial DNA has a tenfold greater mutation rate than nuclear DNA and far less repair capacity. Finally, as we age, NAD levels go into decline. Since NAD is critical to cellular respiration, ATP production also goes into decline. Now, as ATP production goes into decline, causing mitochondrial dysfunction, it can have a huge impact on the aging process. Mitochondrial dysfunction has been identified as a factor in almost every age-related chronic disease there is. Metabolic syndrome, which leads to type 2 diabetes, starts out as mitochondrial dysfunction. Many researchers believe that most cancers are attributable to mitochondrial dysfunction. So is cardiovascular disease, such as heart attacks, strokes, and arteriosclerosis. It's also thought to contribute to the formation of plaques, leading to neurodegenerative diseases such as ALS, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and multiple sclerosis. Many autoimmune diseases, as well as sarcopenia, the loss of muscle mass, and chronic fatigue syndrome can also be traced to mitochondrial dysfunction. And most, if not all, of the hallmarks of aging can be either directly or indirectly attributed to poor mitochondrial health. In fact, mitochondrial dysfunction is one of the hallmarks of aging. So for anyone who's trying to radically extend their own health span, improving and maintaining mitochondrial health is critical. And given that age-related mitochondrial damage can be detected nearly a decade before the onset of permanent mitochondrial damage, and that mitochondrial dysfunction, if caught early, is reversible, that should be telling us that boosting mitochondrial health is one of the best ways to defeat aging. So, how do you go about doing that? Well, traditionally, the best ways to improve mitochondrial health can be broken down into two categories: exercise and nutrition. I know, it's really kind of remarkable how many anti-aging and life-extending benefits can be derived from simply eating healthy food and including a little exercise in our daily routine. Now, nutrition can be broken down even further into what you consume and how you eat. Like so many other aspects of longevity, for mitochondrial health, you should be eating whole, organic foods that are minimally processed or refined. You should be taking supplements like vitamins B, C, and E, and minerals like magnesium, selenium, and zinc, as well as nutraceuticals like alpha-lipoic acid, CoQ10, PPQ, and urolithin A, which I've done a previous video on and which is supposed to optimize mitophagy. But how you eat can be just as important as what you eat for mitochondrial health. Intermittent fasting has been shown to be beneficial for the mitochondria. It can help balance mitochondrial fusion and fission, as well as helping to modulate fat metabolism. Occasional detoxing can also be beneficial to mitochondrial health. But as beneficial as good nutrition is, exercise is even more important. And the best form of exercise for mitochondrial health is high-intensity interval training. HIIT puts a big demand on ATP, and the mitochondria respond by upregulating the production of ATP. They also respond to physical stress by triggering mitochondrial biogenesis. They generate new mitochondria. HIIT also triggers autophagy, more specifically mitophagy. Mitochondria that fail to meet the need for higher levels of ATP get broken down and recycled, with their components being used to create new mitochondria through biogenesis. And HIIT works pretty fast to restore mitochondrial function. In tests, subjects who performed HIIT were able to improve mitochondrial function in as little as 30 days. That's not bad. Okay, so that takes care of the traditional approaches to boosting mitochondrial health. But in recent years, science has learned a lot more about the mitochondria. And these new discoveries have led to some interesting protocols to improve our health, the health of our mitochondria. And one of them is a peptide called SS31. Now, this peptide goes by some other names, including Bendavia, Olamapertide, and MTP-131. In order to understand how it works, we need to take a look at a molecule called cardiolipin. Cardiolipin is a phospholipid. It's only found in the mitochondria, and it's enriched in the inner mitochondrial membrane. Its conical shape can cause this inner membrane to buckle, forming Christie curvatures, those wrinkles or valleys in the structure of the mitochondrial inner membrane. And it's in these Christie curvatures that most of the ATP is produced. Deficiency in cardiolipin can result in absent or disorganized Christi structures, impairing ATP production. Now, it's required for the stability and activity of protein complexes on the inner mitochondrial membrane, and it integrates with all of the cellular respiratory complexes. So, it's considered the glue that stabilizes the proteins of the electron transport chain. However, cardiolipin oxidizes with age, and this oxidation can result in the loss of these Christi curvatures. Loss of cardiolipin destabilizes respiratory complexes, increasing electron leak and ROS production. That's where the SS31 peptide comes in. SS31 is a synthetic tetrapeptide, which means that it has four amino acid bonds bound together through peptide bonds. They're highly water soluble, yet they're readily taken up through the cells by passive diffusion. Now, these SS31 peptides are considered cloaked or stealth peptides because they can evade cellular membranes, even penetrating the blood-brain barrier. And studies show that SS31 peptides interact selectively with cardiolipin on the inner mitochondrial membrane through electrostatic interactions. So there's this theory on how they work. The binding of the SS peptides to cardiolipin likely increases lipid packing, which induces tighter curvatures. However, this has not been demonstrated experimentally. The likely method of action is that when SS31 interacts with cardiolipin, it pulls in the pointy end of the cone-shaped molecule and tighter, it pulls it in tighter, resulting in the tightening of the curvature. If aging causes a disorganization or absence of Christi structures, and if ATP is primarily produced in these structures, then anything that tightens up these curvatures should result in more ATP production. Now, like I said, this hasn't been demonstrated experimentally yet, even though a company called Stealth Biotherapeutics has been working on it. But here's something to consider. First, they weren't really working to treat mitochondrial dysfunction. They were trying to treat primary mitochondrial myopathy, which is an inherited mitochondrial disease that can cause extreme fatigue and muscle weakness. And they were measuring success by using the 6-minute walking test and another test called the primary mitochondrial myopathy symptom assessment total fatigue score, which is a patient-reported outcome tool that measures fatigue and muscular weakness. So for someone who is still in the early stages of age-related mitochondrial dysfunction, when it's still reversible, I'm not so sure that this peptide doesn't provide work. And I've heard anecdotal evidence that it's actually quite effective. So we'll have to wait and see how this plays out. So there's another technology that's being developed that looks a lot more promising. In 2006, it was first discovered that mitochondria can exist outside of the cells, in circulation. That means that these nomad mitochondria can travel throughout the body. Furthermore, it turns out that these extracellular mitochondria were actually exchanging mitochondrial content, such as mitochondrial DNA. Now, this revolutionized our understanding of the mitochondria. Stem cells can donate some of their mitochondria to other cells through exosomes, and there's some evidence that this mechanism is part of the therapeutic effect of stem cell therapies. Blood platelets, which have a lifespan of only a week or two, eject their mitochondria into the blood when these cells are naturally degraded. The organelles are encapsulated within extracellular vesicles called mitlets. Immune cells spontaneously take up these platelet mitochondria to augment their own energy production. These internal mitochondrial transfers are a process conserved by evolution to reuse these extremely valuable cell components. A paper titled Mitochondria Makeover, Unlocking the Path to Healthy Longevity, published just a couple of months ago, takes a look at how artificial mitochondrial transfer transplant might impact aging and longevity. In light of recent advances in interconnected pathways that may contribute to longevity and reduce age-associated diseases, mitochondria emerge as a key factor in aging decay. Mitochondria serve as a central hub connecting all the other hallmarks of aging. This is a really interesting paper, and I encourage everyone to read it. They wrap it all up with this statement. In the pursuit of achieving healthy longevity, we have discovered that intricate interactions among aging hallmarks converge upon a central player, the mitochondria. This dynamic organelle, long recognized for its pivotal role in energy production, management, and metabolism, has now emerged as a linchpin connecting the dots among distinct aging hallmarks, from genomic instability to telomere attrition, from cellular senescence to chronic inflammation. Mitochondria stand at the nexus of these age-related processes. Recent breakthroughs in our understanding of natural mitochondrial transfer and artificial mitochondrial transfer transplant have illuminated a path towards restoring mitochondrial function, regenerating cellular vitality, and rejuvenating aging cells, tissues, and organs. These nomad mitochondria, migrating between cells, enriching recipient cells with essential functions, and potentially mitigating the effects of other aging hallmarks, present new strategies for extending healthy lifespans. Kind of says it all, doesn't it? A company called Mitrix Bio is attempting to take advantage of these new discoveries about the mitochondria by developing a system that could take stem cells that match the patient's genetic profile, containing young, pristine mitochondria, and then grow them in their own bioreactors. The resulting mitochondria are then extracted and packaged with membranes. They're bundled into these vesicles called mitlets, whose membranes are studded with specific receptors for whatever tissue is being targeted. In October of 2022, Mitrix announced that they had tested their homegrown mitlets aimed at the immune system of older mice with sepsis and H1N1 virus. The mitlet-injected mice showed reductions in inflammatory cytokines and significantly improved survival against infection. According to the company, the resulting rejuvenation they saw would be the equivalent of reversing the age of human immune system by 30 years. According to Mitrix founder and CEO Tom Benson, they consider mitochondrial rejuvenation a prerequisite to many other types of age reversal therapies like cellular reprogramming and senolytics. In the case of cellular reprogramming, the cell's genome is restored, but without high-functioning mitochondria to carry out the restored genomic program, the overall effect could be limited. Likewise, removing senescent cells might only be a temporary reprieve if the energy production in the remaining cells isn't enough to prevent them from eventually slipping into senescence. If Mitrix can successfully bring these therapies to market, it will be yet another tool in the longevity toolkit that has the potential to significantly extend healthy lifespans. And like cellular reprogramming, senolytics, and other rejuvenation interventions, it's something to keep an eye on. Okay, that's it for this video. If you want to learn more about the mitochondria, check out this playlist. I'm out of here. Catch you next week.